Several of them, like 30. This afternoon's session is on basic approaches to the psychology of reasoning. As I say here, it's impossible to introduce fully the basic room in the psychology of reasoning in a single talk. The subject is too vast. But I'm going to try to cover some fundamental points, focusing on conditions and deductive inferences. I should warn you that I take a particular line in the Bayesian approach. As I say, there's a great deal of work in this in psychology, in all parts of psychology, in many parts of psychology. And different views are represented. And I represent point. Perhaps you could call it an extreme. In traditional psychological studies of deduction, we ask participants to assume that the premises are true and to say what's necessary or false. This is an assumption-based and binary approach to the study of reasoning. In contrast, the Bayesian approach is belief-based and probabilistic. We can make any assumptions we like. We can assume that all cats are rats. But this does not usually help us to acquire rational beliefs and make rational decisions. Useful inferences in both everyday and scientific reasoning generally come from premises that are uncertain to some degree. Hypotheses that are uncertain more formally, but might be reasonable to believe, again, to some degree. Here we have what would be quite a typical experiment in the traditional approach. We ask participants to assume all cats are rats and all rats are bats. Does it necessarily follow? We ask them that all cats are rats. All right, so Serge referred to the form of this reasoning. Goes all the way back to Aristotle. And it came to be called Barber, this particular syllogism. All A are B, all B are C. Therefore, all A are C. What we find asking participants whether this inference is valid or not is that a large number will say that it doesn't follow, that it doesn't necessarily follow. And the Bayesian response to that has been to say, oh, well, look, this is very unnatural. We're asking people to assume propositions which they know to be false and obviously false. And you give them a conclusion that they know to be false, and obviously they're going to reject things. There's a great deal of work in the Bayesian approach on inductive inferences of pressure. Okay, so that's the traditional deductive inference. Here we have an inductive inference. You could ask the participants, how likely is it that cats have limited color vision, given evidence that rats have limited coverage. There's a certain similarity between rats and cats. But rats are rodents, they are mostly vegetarian, perhaps they may need color vision more than cats do. Perhaps cats can get along with just black and white, and with their forward-facing eyes have an ocular vision. So we might not think this is a very strong argument. A stronger argument might be, how likely is it that cats have rabies in some area, given evidence that rats have rabies? This kind of difference is also been studied. You might get participants saying that the conclusion is more probable than the rats, right? It's on a different basis, not the basis of similarity, but some kind of causal link. Cats eat rats. And so people have some certain sorts of ways of dealing with evidence and with causation that we might hope to account for in the Bayesian approach. David, who follows me, is going to say more about this. Now, at this point, it might appear that the Bayesian approach is best suited to the study of inductive or causal inference. And it could well be combined with a kind of binary or traditional approach, as Henry explained. However, there is a necessary connection between probability and deduction, and the Bayesian approach can be applied the study of the past. This justifies the use, some of us think, of the new paradigm, because we are going after logic as well as inductive reasoning. And we are ambitious, or you could say greedy. We want it all. We want the whole field. We just don't want induction, which is big enough. You might say, why can't you be satisfied with induction? Bayesian's are perfect for that. No, we want deduction as well. We want the lot. This is what makes me a radical. Now, do I say to introduce this, I refer to a very famous psychological experiment on the conjunction fallacy by Erskine and Conway, 1983. We've already heard them referred to earlier in Ruth's talk to very famous psychologists. In this experiment, back in 1983, the participants, for those of you who don't know it, many of you will, are given a little description of a woman named Linda. Actually, there is a description of a man named Bill, who's a bit of a geek. But nobody ever refers to Bill. This is an interesting psychological fact about this experiment. I've talked about it all the world, way over to Japan and back, and nobody is interested in Bill. Everybody is interested in this guy. Linda, looking back, think of the participants in 1983, you're looking back a few years, and when the experiment was run before that, Linda went to Berkeley in the late 60s. She did social sciences. She was into social questions. She was anti-war, pro-civil rights movement. Okay. So kind of stereotype is created. A young woman you might think is a feminist. You might think it's quite young. I think probably she's a feminist. And indeed, participants think it's quite probable she's a feminist in America. Perhaps they're reasoning, well, of course, they're being honest about Linda a few years, 5 years or so later, after she graduates from Berkeley. What is she doing? Oh, she could be working for a kind of cooperative bank, or a bank that helps women with in trouble, or Hispanic, disadvantaged Hispanic. She could be in that problem. But what about the probability that Linda is a bank teller? Oh, I see. Of course, the picture is an awful bank teller. What about that? That now bank teller summons up a particular stereotype, and it clashes with the Linda stereotype. This is a standard sort of explanation. I'm being rough in America. And then participants say, oh no, well, Linda can't be that. She doesn't fit that, my image of a bank. So they say it's very improbable. All right. Now this is a fallacy, as the person who comes points out, it's a bias. And what is their explanation of why it is a bias? That is because inferring Q from P and Q is logically valid. Right. That is an inference logicians call and elimination. There can hardly be a more basic inference. An inference that obviously valid. And that means, as Tversky and Kahneman point out, we should judge that the probability of Q is greater than or equal to the probability of P and Q. So here we have P's and Q's, right? Feminists and bank tellers. And here we have bank tellers. All bank tellers, right? They're bigger. It's a bigger set. It includes a subset. Well, of course, that is what validity means. There is a necessary connection between validity and elementary set theory. Validity is a propositional logic like this. But moreover, there's a necessary connection between validity and probability. The two are necessarily tied together. Right? And we can actually turn this around. Instead of defining validity in terms of truth, a valid inference is an inference. An inference is valid if and only if its conclusion must be true given the truth of its premises. We can say that an inference is pre-valid, that's probabilistically valid, p-valid for short, I'll say that, if and only if the probability of its premise cannot coherently be greater than the probability of its conclusion. That means, for a valid inference classically conceived, you cannot go from truth to falsity. That's rule out for valid inference. Probabilistic validity is you cannot go from high probability to low probability. It's ruled out coherently. What is coherence? Coherence is the Bayesian generalization of consistency. Bayesianism is a more general approach than the classical approach, and in fact it encompasses the classical approach. I'll say more about this later. If we want to be classical, we want to drop down to the traditional classical view, we simply let the probability
1 equals true and probability 0 equals false, and we drop down. And then this this definition becomes equivalent to saying we cannot go from true to falsity. For a single premise inference, to keep it simple, we cannot possibly go from truth in a premise to falsity in a conclusion. That is from 1 to 0. So we turn this around and we make probability fundamental. As is already said about probability is fundamental. And more general. And you can say, what does this give us? What is it? Participants are making inferences from their beliefs. We do it every day. Scientists do it, ordinary people do it. Are they conforming to logic or not? Sometimes they won't be, of course. They'll be making inductive inferences. But sometimes they might be conforming to logic, to deductive inferences. How can we tell, we say in the traditional approach? We can't tell. But in the new approach, we can tell. If they assign, I won't go back to that. If we assign, if they infer Q from P and Q, but they assign a higher probability of P and Q, then they have made a logical mistake. It's not an inductive mistake. It is a mistake in probability logic. Okay. And in fact, we have run that experiment. This wasn't done before. In the original diversity common experiment, it was even most of the experiments reported were between participants. That is, you didn't have one of the same participants being given P and Q and Q. You can have within experiments in which the same participant is given both, but they're separated. And you have P, you have Linda up here towards the top, you have Linda is a feminist and a bank teller, and then you have Linda is a farmer, Linda is a police woman, blah, 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 and Linda is a bank teller, and blah, and her class is Linda. But we actually got people to infer the one, the other. So does Q follow from P and Q? What is your estimate of the probability of the premise? What is your estimate of the probability of the conclusion? And they still commit the fallacy. They still make the premise of higher probability of the conclusion. Just how deep this fallacy is, right? And it's something that we have discovered in the Bayesian approach. Okay. The Bayesian approach aims to integrate and unify studies of reasoning and decision making. Our aim, the more ambitious ingredient on this, is to create one field, not, as we have at the moment, the psychology of reasoning and judgment and decision making, but just one field. Judgment and decision making, that's most people, if you ask them, in what part of psychology does diversity and Kahneman's experiment fall, they will say judgment and decision making. It's not probability, it's not probability bias. It's actually not a logical bias, as Tversky and Kahneman themselves were originally clear. It is a logical, people commit a logical fallacy, a fallacy in deduction. Right? Now, another point about the Bayesian approach I have mentioned yet, it's belief-based. The Bayesian account of probability is that it's subjective probability. It is a degree of belief, a subjective degree of belief. It goes back to the great founders of subjective probability theory in the 20th century, Ramsey and Dufanetti, and they initially, if you look back at their works, they were also very clear about this. Ramsey spoke about the logic of partial belief, the logic of degrees of belief, in other words, you guys know what Kahneman would say now. And Dufanetti said, the traditional approach is the logic of certainty, because when you make an assumption, you treat those assumptions as if they were certain. But I am going to propose, said Dufanetti, a logic of uncertainty. A logic of probability. He also has another phrase he used. But Bayesianism, as many of you will also know, is closely linked to this idea of revision and updating. And this is another point on which we could differ from the traditional approach, which we view as static. The participants make assumptions. Or perhaps beliefs are sometimes stuffy, but they're fixed. The Bayesian approach emphasizes belief change and revision via Bayes' theorem, of course. Bayes' theorem tells us how to revise, according to Bayesian, our beliefs over time. We have a hypothesis, we don't fully believe it. It has some prior probability, perhaps relatively low. We run an experiment, and we end up believing the hypothesis more strongly. So we revise. So we go our probability P1, which represents our subjective probability at time P1 before we run the experiment, to P2 after P2. It's a different probability for H. It's the posterior for the hypothesis rather than the prior. So I'm going to, I'm not going to say quite so much about this in this talk, but as we, in the Bayesian approach, view it, this is quite a serious limitation of the traditional approach. It is not a dynamic. It is not about belief. First of all, it's not about belief. It's about assumptions. Secondly, it's not about revision and updating. It's not about dynamic reasoning. All right. I'm going to focus, because this is my research area, and because the differences between the two approaches are brought into sharp focus, as we've already had some indication of this in Jeff's talk, they're brought into very sharp focus in our disagreement over conditionals, natural language conditionals, at P and Q. And really, we should focus a great deal on conditionals. They are basic to reasoning. Basically, any bit of reasoning we do from Q to P, from P to Q, that's even like the condition from P to Q, can be summed up with a conditional if P and Q. We get to the end, blah, 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 and from P, blah, blah, and make a derivation Q. So therefore, if P and Q. But I think I've already said enough. Okay. The impetus for our approach comes, quite a bit of that came historically from dissatisfaction with traditional accounts of the conditional. When psychologists first started to work on conditional reasoning, they had a model in mind. Elementary, deductive, extensional logic, which was originally designed by Frege and Whitehead and Russell for mathematics. And that contains a conditional called the material conditional. We saw what Jeff, in effect, gave us the truth table for us. This material conditional, as sometimes called material implication, it's logically equivalent to not P or Q. Material implication is a misnomer because for if P, then Q is true as a material implication. There doesn't have to be any intuitive notion of implication because it just means not P or Q. If we say that this conditional is what we use in ordinary affairs for indicative conditionals in natural language, then we have two paradoxes. One is that it is valid to infer if P and Q from not P. So if not P holds, it is automatically true that if P, then Q. It logically follows. It's a valid inference for the material conditional, obviously, because the material conditional means not P and Q. That's just what it means. It's logically true to that. And second paradox is it's valid to infer if P, then Q from Q. Jeff referred to this. A conditional with a false antecedent and a true consequent is true in the Venerable Model approach. Right? That means this inference is valid. Okay, so now here, and we think of this in terms of dynamic reasoning. I'm worried about my health at my age. I'm getting older. So let us say I'm taking steps, watching my diet, getting more exercise, that sort of thing. And I think my health is improving day after day by day goes by. Maybe I take my blood pressure. I have some evidence that it's improving, right? I go on like that. All right, so I consider the conditional. If I take up smoking, my health will improve. Right? That's got to be getting more and more probable as every day passes. As it's more and more probable, which each day that passes, that my health improves, then this conditional, supposing it's a material conditional, meaning not P or Q, is becoming more and more probable. In Jeff's terms, it's becoming more and more true, right? Because it validly follows. Remember, this validly follows from here. Therefore, the probability, remember Tversky's comment, the probability of this must be greater than or equal to the probability of this. Right? Simple as that, follows directly from the notion of validity. But that's absurd. It will be becoming more and more probable that if I take up smoking, then my health will improve, as I do all these other things, exercise, diet, so on. Then, of course, I would think I would make the decision to take up smoking. Wouldn't I? I would reflect, oh, it's become highly probable that if I take up smoking, my health will improve. So I'll take up smoking. That will help me as well. Obviously, that's the inverse fallacy. Nobody would commit that. And indeed, people reject this inference in psychological experiments from theory. In Bayesian terms, this inference is not just an invalid inference for the conditional I will specify, which is not a particular condition. It is a grossly invalid inference. We can make distinctions between invalid inferences and the Bayesian approach. There are invalid ones that might be good inductive inferences, and there are invalid ones that are absolutely ghastly. Right? We call them totally uninformative invalid inferences. And this is one of them. This is a really useless inference. Okay, now, when psychologists first started to think about, I'm repeating myself here, getting an account of ordinary people's reasoning, they had this model in mind of extensional propositional logic, the P's and Q's. Some of you will have learned in elementary logic. They had this in mind, and they thought, oh, we'll fiddle with this in some way. We'll say, okay, we have the truth table which Jeff showed you for this, but we'll call those the mental models, P, or not P or Q, of course, it's P, Q, not P, Q, not P, not Q, just to get it up. And we'll say those are the models people have. At first they were truth-making models, like the principle of truth. Now they tend to be more possibilities. But anyway, there they are. But this people don't represent these all the time for reasons of efficiency. They only represent the first one, generally, the initial one. Gray and O'Brien in mental logic theory adopted some of the rules for the material conditional and dropped others. In fact, they dropped the first paradox. They didn't like this one at all. Considered it absurd. But this one they kept for some reason. I don't know why, but they did keep it. Okay, this was a very influential paper in the 1990s. Ryan and mental logic theory often set against mental model theory. Then, back then, it's what we had done from Mary and Byrne. And they gave the natural language condition on saying mental models is not peer review. But they distinguish, as I've just said, I jumped ahead of myself, an initial model, PQ, and at that stage they use brackets. They go on more recently in using three dots, PQ and three dots. The brackets mean that P is exhaustively represented, and the other models are not P models, not PQ, not PQ. And it's and P, for example, NP is referring to Q from if P then Q and P. This has always looked to me like a notational variant of P then Q, and so I've always considered this theory a kind of mental logic, even though mental model theory says to be very different from mental logic. But anyway, the two, that's been debated, obviously, but the two theories, what I want to draw attention to, is the two theories are like endorsing this inference as valid, the second paradox. That second paradox there. They both endorse it as valid. Now, I've already been through this. I've already set this slide, so I can skip over this. Both theories imply a result that is theoretically highly counterintuitive and which goes against the psychological evidence. People do not infer if P then Q from Q, and nor do they consider that the probability of if P then Q is necessarily greater than or equal to the probability of Q. Okay, now recently, I want to talk, it could be said that I'm being unfair to mental model theory, and I should mention, mental model theory actually has an explanation for why people reject the second paradox in a kind of binary setting. I don't know that they have an explanation for why people violate it when they begin probability judgments or anything, but in any case, that really has become irrelevant now because Johnson, Laird, Kimani, and Jeff Goodwin have revised mental model theory. And it's no longer the case that the paradoxes are valid. Both paradoxes fail in this revision, 2015 revision in transient cognitive dissonance. So now it's Q still has the same energy models as non-human Q, but or introduction is invalid. So it's invalid to infer not P or Q from not P. Equivalently, it's invalid to infer P or Q from P, and that means it's invalid to, and sorry, yes, and it's invalid to, of course, it's invalid to infer Q, not P or Q from Q, and it's invalid to infer the Q from Q. Right? So you've got rid of the paradoxes, but they're left with this problem as we see it, that or introduction is invalid. We consider or introduction obviously valid. And we know there are psychological results that people resist endorsing it, we think on pragmatic grounds. They endorse it at rates above chance level, but you say to people, look, Mary is in the library, Linda's in the library, is Linda in the library or in the computer lab? They don't like that input so much. Right? Mental model theories, old mental model theory said that it throwed information away at the kind of pragmatic explanation. We would favor that broadly, but not that specific explanation, but that's called sort of explanation. But anyway, they don't have to worry about that now because that inference is invalid. Okay, so we know. How is this coming up? I think I've said enough about that. Let me just explain briefly what an addition mental model theory, P over Q, means. As actually just showed in his slide, it now is a statement about possibility. P and Q is possible, P and not Q is possible, and not P and Q is possible. Right? It's a statement to me. So we, now our difficulty with this is really to ask for clarification. Perhaps in panel discussion, informal discussions here, we'll get clarification. Because what notion of possibility is this? In a truth table, the rows of a truth table are possible in the logical sense. So this, of course, would make almost every disjunction true and have a probability of one. Because it's always the case that P and Q is possible. Not P and Q is possible. Right? All sorts of disjunctions that you would think can't be true are highly improbable, would turn out to be obviously true on this basis. I can say, truthfully, I'm going to fly back to Paris and London. I have a ticket to Paris, therefore I'm going to Paris and London. Moreover, because of the strikes in Paris and France near me, there are problems which have happened. My plane will be diverted to London, so I'm going back. But I can't just choose two Canadian cities at random, or towns, like Yellow Knife and Lubeck, and say, I'm going to, by the way, I'm going to go back to Paris or London after this, and I'm also going to go to Yellow Knife or Nunavut. That's false. But it's highly improbable anyway. And yet, it's certainly possible. It's logically possible. It's even physically possible for me to go. I go to the airport and catch a plane. And moreover, I want to go. I've always wanted to go to the two places. There's great hiking in them. So I look forward someday to hiking, especially if you and it might be a bit too far north for me. There's certainly Yellow Knife, but there's still some forest there, so I like where that goes. Yeah, but it doesn't hold for it. Okay, actually a curious result. Unless we have some very specific notion of possibility here, then the probability of P or Q on this new account is almost always one, and at least that's what we charge. By the way, we, a group of us, Barajan et al., a whole group of us have a reply to the Johnson-Merritt et al. Article in the text. We have things on this one. A proposition here that doesn't have a probability of one is P or not P. That's because P and not P is impossible. So it fails. It fails the test. See, or introduction is supposed to be invalid because from P alone, we cannot, they say, we can only tell that P and not Q is possible. I mean, I don't know why that follows, but anyway. We certainly can't tell that P and Q together are possible, let's say, as he holds, so therefore, the inference is invalid. And here, I give a proof, another problem for them, is it? And elimination, which I've referred to in connection with diversity and common. This is an obviously valid inference, and people endorse it to a very high degree. has come to the pay is valid. Okay, then of course it must be valid to infer not P and Q for not P. But not P and Q is equivalent to not P or not Q. And therefore, from not P, we have derived not P or not Q, which is order deduction. And by using negations up here, not P and not Q, we can derive from and elimination P, therefore P or Q. So, in other words, if or introduction is invalid, then and elimination is invalid. And that is, you say, observe against all evidence. Of course, this depends, my little proof here depends on this link between not P and Q, not P or not Q, which is the more so-called De Morgan law in logic. I think it's intuitive that, but perhaps I reject that. Okay. Another problem, again, on the conditions now with the new approach is, look, here we have an instance. If P or Q then are, and P, you're given P, surely it follows that R, and it's a very intuitive response. If my car is stolen or burned out, then the insurance company pays a replacement cost. My car is stolen, I expect the insurance company to pay a replacement cost. If you were doing this in elementary logic, you would have if P or Q and R, P, and then you would infer P or Q, and then you would use the modus ponens. Now the inference is valid directly, and it's very intuitively. As I've just given you an intuitive example. And it is impossible to argue. There are various questions I would like to ask about the relation to mental health. But it's not possible to have some sort of manipulation with the degrees of freedom there to make this inference valid when or introduction is invalid. Because this is really equivalent, given that it's ponens, this inference is equivalent to or introduction you see here. See, this is a topology. If P or Q, then P or Q as a topology. Right? It's always true, so it drops out. P, then this is an instance of if P or Q, then R. Just make Q P or Q. Say, if P or Q were R or delta, that delta can be anything, so it can be P or Q. That's a topology. So when you're going to P, if this form an inference is valid, then we infer P and Q. And we have one introduction. So you can't have the one after. Okay. Yes. Sorry to be so negative so far. This is. We all have, hopefully, get some clarification on what this revision is telling us. But what is our alternative? And the alternative we propose has been called the probability conditional and also the conditional event. That was Diffinetti's term, the conditional event. So for us, if P and Q is not, it's not equivalent, the probability of P and Q is not equivalent to the probability of P and Q for a natural language conditional, indicative conditional. And we propose what is called the equation. It's such a basic principle for this for the Bayesian approach to conditionals that we call it the equation. It is a basic. So once you remove the probability of P and Q and substitute the conditional probability of Q given P in your reason, then the correct and we hold normative theory for what you're doing is Bayesian. Bayes' theorem itself is about conditional probability. It's about the probability of a hypothesis given some evidence derived from the evidence given the hypothesis, the probability. What do we get? Gravitational waves. Okay. Einstein's theory logically implies there are gravitational waves. So the probability is 1. Alternative theories don't have a probability of 1. And Bayes' theorem then tells us we to go the other way. Right? From Einstein's theory, we get gravitational waves. We make a measurement, we discover gravitational waves. We revise and update, and our confidence in Einstein increases. Okay. Such a conditional is true when P and Q holds, false when P and not Q holds, and has the value of the conditional probability when not P holds. No, this is my response to what Jeff says. When not P holds, the value of the conditional is the conditional probability. And so, if we identify probability one with truth and probability zero with false, then sometimes a conditional with a false antecedent is true in our account. It has probability one. Because the conditional probability, and actually many of the conditionals Jeff considered have exactly that problem. There's so-called deterministic conditionals. We say they're conditionals with probability one. Right? Because the conditional probability is one. It's obvious that all those conditionals that were deterministic, called deterministic, were such in the frequency distribution that the conditional probability is one. Okay. The Ramsey test for indicatives. I'm going to say more about them. I'm going to say something about counterfactuals later, but I need, in light of what has already said, to stress this. This is the Ramsey test for indicatives, what we propose, the version of the test we propose for indicative conditionals. You see, it's a bit odd talking about false antecedent cases. I'm trying to tie this talk, I'm changing my talk a bit to tie it to preceding talk. See, suppose I say, this is an indicative conditional. If I am standing behind this screen, you cannot see my face. Right? That's a false antecedent. What? Isn't it a strange conditional? We say it's voided as an indicative conditional, because there's no indicative fact that makes it true. Right? There's a fact about the opacity of the screen that's relevant to the counterfactual, which we should use. If I were behind this screen, you would not see my face. Right? So when we have a conditional, it's incorrect. In some sense, I hope this is common ground, in some sense or other, to be explained, it is incorrect in English to use an indicative conditional when the antecedent is clearly and obviously false. I hope this is not controversial. Right? So something incorrect about my saying, if I am standing behind this screen, you cannot see my face. What I should say in English is, if I were behind this screen, then you would not see my face. Right? But also, I just mentioned in passing here, I think curious thing about indicative conditionals. Suppose I do stand on the screen, I won't do it. Much as you might want me to, but suppose I did. I can just come around here and stand on it, yeah? And then I shouted over the top. Now, is the conditional, if I am standing behind the screen and you cannot see my face, true or false? I was curious, isn't it? It would again be a non-conditional. Why? If you were behind the screen, you would say, if I am behind the screen and you cannot see my face. I don't use the indicative behind the screen, and I don't use the indicative in front of the screen. I use the counterfactual. Why is that? So, indicatives exist in this kind of no man's land of uncertainty. Right? When we are certain, we will assert the conjunction, or we will insert a counterfactual. Right? Yeah. And the indicative conditional has its place in our thought. Right, this characteristic of the examples Valerie gave, right? We don't know. We don't know about the antecedent. We don't know about the connection. We're not sure about the connection. Okay, now another point I want to make here is about assertion. Actually, Jeff quoted a statement. It's one thing to talk about the meaning of conditionals. And for us, the meaning of conditional is explained in terms of the Ramsey test, which actually I didn't get to the Ramsey test, you can see it there. Ramsey test on the P, that you suppose P is true, and under that supposition make a judgment about Q. I suppose that I take up smoking, however much my health is improving, I suppose I take up smoking, what follows? From my knowledge base follows that my health will deteriorate, it will get worse. So, a good result of that conditional I used as an example in the problem. Now, an assertion. Here again, this is yet another difference between us and the government policy. We put great emphasis on an assertion. What is an assertion? It is a speech act. There are sentences of language, and they have meanings, whatever count have meaning, but an assertion is an action. It is a speech act. So, when we assert a conditional, or less, we are performing an action as much as raising one's hands or saying, yes, I agree. Right? So, yeah, for the Bayes, an action is performed. Again, this is how we approach unifying reasoning with decision making. An action, as people with judgment and decision making would say, is performed for some expected utility. It's to achieve a goal which has a certain probability for us. That is expected to be taken. Now, when it's an assertion said to be true, I would say, in that quote I did say, an assertion, right, is, in my view, is asserted as true when a condition was asserted. It's asserted as true when the probability of being given to me is high enough in context. Now, I think Jeff has clearly specified a context where you, well, you can actually see the counter examples, right? And in such a context, we would only use, I think its results establishes, it's a good, good thing to establish, that people will tend to use true only when the conditional probability is given to is 1, which of course means that it's high, right? So I think this is going along with my view, right? But there are other contexts in which people will assert if P then Q and the conditional probability as true when the conditional probability is high but not quite 1. Like you consider in a court of law, you ask people, look, if the suspect's fingerprints and DNA are on the murder weapon, then he's guilty. Is that true or not? They will say, it's true. You ask an expert on a witness stand. There's two people I spoke about, maybe that might be talking to a cafe or a pub. But if you ask an expert, scientific expert, put them on the stand, they might not use the word true. They might just specify the probability. They might use Bayes' theorem and what we know about DNA profiling and actually give a number of probability. And of course, that sort of causes certain troubles in a courtroom. Basically, there's the different attitudes, the different judgments of the context of the scientist or traditional, the context the scientist works in, and what the jurors are thinking of. Okay, I specify some, I'm going to have to move on quickly, I think. Evidence here, this is going to be available, this you can look at this citation here, and the evidence. We have for such assertions as if global warming continues, then London will be flooded. And people tend to judge the probability of that equals the conditional probability. Except sometimes in more recent work, we've seen that people resist such an identification for so-called missing link conditions. If global warming continues, then life will be found on Mars. And certainly, it's at least pragmatic in terms of or pragmatic fact that people look for connections between the consequence. And they don't just assert a conditional because the probability of the consequence is high. The conditional probability could be high because the probability of the consequence is high. It has nothing to do with the disease. And I think we have a great psychological tendency or drive to look for connections. When we read this, many of us perhaps think, but look, perhaps there's a link here. Global warming continues, we get into a panic about the Earth, we think we have to move to another planet, we get busy in scientific research, we spend more money and effort getting to Mars and doing research there, and perhaps that makes it more likely life will be found there. Now this is something that needs to be investigated more fully. Okay, now I get the general definition here, these missing link conditional findings. All right, I give here, on this slide, the general definition of probabilistic validity. Earlier, I just gave the definition for a single premise, but you can give a definition for multi-premises, as many premises as you please. And basically, it comes down to the same thing as the earlier definition. You cannot go from high probability to low probability in a probabilistically valid inference. Put it in terms of uncertainty, which is the technical term we use here, you cannot increase uncertainty. An inductive inference is allowed to increase uncertainty, but an inductive inference isn't. A deductive inference, deductively valid inference, cannot increase uncertainty from that kind of premises. I'll move. You can see these technical points here. You can see. Let's consider those boundaries. If P then Q, P therefore Q, and we look at people's beliefs, degrees of beliefs, and let's say they judge the conditional, with the conditional probability 0.6, and the probability of the minor premise to be 0.6. Okay, so we have now a classic sorry, I won't use the classic. The Bayesian approach, we're looking at people's beliefs, their degrees of belief. And here we have the degree of belief in both the major minor premises 0.6. By looking in our Bayesian approach, we can go through this technical argument here, and we can show that someone is only coherent if the conclusion, the probability for the conclusion of Murdoch's findings, which is Q, if P then Q, P then 0.2, is greater than or equal to 0.36. So it can't be too low. In other words, you can't go from too much probability in the premises to too low in the condition. But this is the important point I want to draw your attention to. The probability of Q cannot be too high either. It cannot be above 0.6, we can prove. Oh, this is a new proposal we are making. In the classical approach, you can't even, it doesn't make sense to say that people could endorse Murdoch's findings too highly. Murdoch's problem. Everybody endorses Murdoch's problem. The endorsement rate is the ceiling, as we said. If P then Q, P therefore Q almost everybody. Yeah, but they could be putting too much endorsement on Q. And this, you said, what is this? This is a strange sort of bias. I never heard of this bias having more confidence in the conclusion of a deductive inference than you should have. If it does have a name, it's called overconfidence. Right? It's too much. You're overconfident in your conclusion. And it can happen in deduction as much as induction. We can go over these technicalities later. Okay, I say something here about dynamic reasoning and brief updating. I think I've already emphasized its importance in Bayesianism. I need to move on a bit. I want to go into counterfactuals. It's more relevant to topics covered in the morning. Okay, so let us go now to counterfactuals. And I'll give you some idea of our account. Everything up to now has been, or almost all of it has been on our account of the negatives. What is a counterfactual? It's quite hard to define. Actually, I've used this screen here. I gave it already given you an example of a counterfactual here. If I have a cup in this hand, then it has tea in it. Is that? What is that? Perhaps Jeff can tell us whether it's true or false. I know I have a cup of tea in my hand, right? So perhaps that makes it true according to mental model theory, but we don't think it makes it true. Then that makes it true. We think it's odd, it's void, and what should be used is a counterfactual. If I had a cup of tea in this hand, then it would have tea in it, and that has a certain probability which we can judge. Suppose David has a cup of tea in his hand, but what do you know about David? He likes coffee in the morning, there's tea in the afternoon, he's from the UK. He's lived in England so long, he likes his tea in the afternoon. Well, don't it's quite dark. For me, everybody in. So now, the Ramsey test for counterfactuals. Here we have to suppose, when we suppose P, of course, we know P to be false for a counterfactual. So when we suppose that P is true, we have to make changes in our belief system, setting aside certain beliefs, otherwise we would just end up with inconsistent beliefs. We would be supposing P, and this would clash with our knowledge of not being able to infer anything. Right? So we have to make these changes. One way to do this is to go back in time to a point at which P was not false, and then use the Ramsey test for indicatives. The probability of the counterfactuals and the conditional probability of that earlier time. Right? There have been some charges that the Ramsey test for counterfactuals, well, here I show that it's intractable, but I've just pointed out you can reduce it to the Ramsey test for indicatives in certain cases. But it is true that there is this problem of specifying how it is we make a supposition and then changes in our beliefs to be able to derive a conclusion. That is a problem. But it's equally a problem for the mental model theory. They say we can envisage counterfactual models, but okay, but then how do we do this envisaging in such a way that we can reason about them? This is an example. We're going to refer to it. Mr. White can go home with his usual route or an unusual route. Let's say he takes an unusual route. takes in the universe. He's distracted, he has a car accident, other people are killed, he's seriously injured, spent many months in hospital, becomes depressed, and an alcoholic, loses his job, is divorced, and kills himself. Right? So as he lays dying, he reflects with deep regret. If he had only taken his usual route home, he would probably have been better off. Now that's what people will say, as Bruce said. We get the counterfact, we get this possible world for counterfactual world for free as it seems to us. People to do this, but how exactly is it constructed cognitively? And reason about, because it's possible. This is, and use their terminology, this is a distant world. The closest world to the actual world is that he takes his usual route home, and exactly the same thing happens. Right? That would be a world that, in terms of similarity, anyway, is closer to the actual world. And therefore, we would think it would be easier to reason about. But it's not the world people think. They think of this more distant world with many changes from the actual world. So how do they make these changes in their representation of the actual world to get this kind of actual world? How is that done in an attractive way? Now, it is remarkable, actually, that there are so few experiments on logical reasoning with counterfactuals. There's a great, rich literature. You can look in the Ritz book or in a recent review article, very rich literature on counterfactuals. But there aren't many experiments on people's logical emphasis. But for example, here is the main one I know, Thompson Turner 2002, and Ruth briefly referred to this, and it establishes the important points she noted, so I won't speak about that. And if this gives me a chance, I have to quickly introduce the example I want to introduce here, a new sort of example to consider. Although it is related to cases we heard this morning and what they were talking about. So we have a conditional English murder that has taken place in an isolated country house. Only the butler or maid could have done it. So there we have a disjunction. Okay? So this is related to something Jeff said. And we would infer that the indicative, as Jeff noted, the equivalent, if the butler did not do it, then the maid did. So either the butler or the maid did it. Right? That's the indicative. If the butler did not do it, then the maid did. But we cannot infer. Suppose now we discover that the butler did do it. We cannot infer that if the butler had not done it, then the maid would have. Right? What we would infer is if the butler had not done it, then the murder would have taken place. That is the inference. Right? Because the butler being the murderer, right? The butler not having done it does not turn the maid into a murderer. Not unless they're in a conspiracy. Of course, it's complicated. These examples are complicated. That's why we need to study them. So in terms of the example Ruth used, very good example, we have the terrorist event, right? And we say, if only the FBI had caught this man, then it would have happened. Of course, that's only going to be true or probable if the man isn't in some sort of conspiracy, terrorist conspiracy, so that if the FBI arrested him, another man would have taken his place and committed the same atrocity. Right? So it's really difficult to work out when these emphases are justified and when not, and this article here makes an attempt to do that, given 2012. Now here we have, again, this is happening by chance. This is the way probability sometimes happens, related to an example discussed, which is in the literature, about contestants and prizes. I put it this way. So a TV presenter tells a contestant that the prize is behind door X or Y, and the contestant will win if he gets it. Now, perhaps the contestant has been mandated. He's had to choose Y. Oh, no, before I get to that, that's the next slide. I'm jumping ahead of myself because I think I'm running out of time here. We started a bit late, but I want to finish out the questions. So the contestant infers that Okay, this is first stage to the whole. If the price is not behind X and it is behind Y, okay, that seems justified. The presenter who has placed the prize behind X infers, if the prize is not behind X, then it has been stolen. Right? Because he has put the prize behind X. So what this difference? Which of these two conditionals is true? They can both be probable in our account. The contestant, if the contestant is incoherent, can be justified in only his condition, and the presenter can be justified in only hers. Right? Subjective, we're talking about subjective probability here, so this is fine. For the presenter, this is fine. But if we stand out and look at it, which is true or justified? Okay, then we change the now the contestant chooses to apply and the prize is behind X. So let us suppose that the contestant has been mandated to choose Y. The contestant might say, if the prize had not been behind X, then I would have won. Huh? So is this contestant justified? Should we not infer that if the prize had not been behind X, then it would have been stolen? And this is what the presenter. Oh, okay, I've got to stop. And I think that is the exciting conclusion. Henry's giving me the sign. I'm sorry to have gone on so long. There's so many interesting points to come up this morning.